Let's talk about stacks in our course data structures. Stack is a popular data structure, very useful one that supports insertion and removal, like all other data structures. It has its own semantic here, which is push for inserts and pop for removals. Top is going to look at the element in the top of the stack only. It will not update the stack at all. It is a read-only operation, but push and pop are like write and read operations. Yes. Basically, we will witness this last in first out behavior when we are dealing with a stack, which is LIFO. It can be analogous to this stack of dishes thing that we encounter in restaurants. The last item placed on the stack will be the first to be removed. Okay, so the youngest one will be the one to be removed, in other words. So same deal with a different figure actually. Push to populate the stack and pop to depopulate the stack to remove items. And top is the other read-only operation. Now let's implement them one by one, as well as other auxiliary operations like isEmpty and the constructors, destructors, that stuff. But before getting into the implementation, I will notice that I will show you three different approaches to implement a stack. One will be based on an array, the other will be based on this pointer manipulation nodes and their connections, and the other one will be very similar to the second one, but in that other one we will be using the linked list ADT, which has been already implemented. So we will be using linked list functions to implement the stack. In the second one we will not use the linked list directly, but we will kind of implemented from scratch. And what is this? There is also exception issues, like trying to remove something from an empty stack. So we will see them one by one. Okay, and another summary slide here. This is going to be about array-based implementation, and these two are the pointer-based implementations. So B and C are very similar. Let's begin with the array-based implementation, which is quite simple actually. You will have an array to store your items. It will have this size of max stack, and there will be this integer index called top, and it will be used to access the top item only. So everything to be done in a stack will be from the upper side, from the top side. If you want to push something, you will push it from the top, so it will be your new top. If you pop something, it will be removed from the top. So you will only have access to that top node, top item, and you will achieve it through this variable called top here. Okay, so you will have some constant max stack size, which is an issue to come up with. So you will probably overshoot this, and it will lead to a waste of memory space. So this is the main disadvantage of this approach. But other than this, it is a quite cool approach. So your data members will be the array of items of type T. Again, template programming happening here. T will be bound to a type during execution, like integer, float, or complex number, whatever. And int top will be the index to the top of the stack. So initially your constructor will set top to minus one, which means that you have an empty stack. So minus one, or actually any negative number is okay, because in the isEmpty test you will look at the negativity of top. If it is negative, then you will return true, which means stack is empty. When you want to push something, you will first look at your top value. If it is like on the boundary, which is the last point it can get, max stack minus one. So if top is equal to max stack minus one, remember here, It means that your very last block is also allocated, so you are not ready to fit one more new item, so you will throw an exception. But this is a rare case, hopefully. In general, we will be dealing with this. We increase top first, so plus plus top. Here it is different than here it is mandatory. If you want to, if you use top plus plus, you will fail. Okay, so this is C++ knowledge. It means that plus plus first update the top. So if the current top value is 7, meaning that you already have 8 elements in your stack, because 0 to 7 has 8 elements, you make it first 8, it will point to the ninth block, and then you insert the item, I don't know, 33 to that index 8, so it will be your ninth item. It is very simple, so we shouldn't talk more about it actually. Similarly, pop is if your stack is empty, I am calling the service function here, then I don't do any pop. I will just throw an exception and quit, or just maybe warn and reiterate. So it depends on your stack exception implementation. But then the real deal is here. In general, I will land to this else block, which will basically reduce top by one. Here, top minus minus or minus minus top, it doesn't make any difference. So in this example, I already have 9 items in my stack, with the last one being 33. If I pop, basically I set top equal to 7 back, so meaning that I have only 8 items. The previous item was 25, maybe, I don't know. Yeah, top and pop is the same as pop functionality here. So we do top minus minus, but the difference is I do some call by reference action here. So this is the reference of the caller variable from your main function or whatever, and you will save that top item in that stack top variable first, and then do minus minus. Okay, so here again, minus minus top will fail. You should do top minus minus. So the ordering of this minus minus operator is important. Yes, get top is probably the simplest function, because you will just look at the top, look at the entry pointed by the top index, and you just set it to your reference variable here called stack top. And we can finish the array-based implementation by noticing that the only disadvantage of this is this initial number of max stack elements. You will probably overshoot, as I mentioned before. Other than this, it is quite efficient, because remember, arrays are contiguous blocks of items. So once you get it, you have this cache-friendly behavior, which will increase efficiency. So that is the advantage. Now let's move to the pointer-based implementation of the stack, where I will keep nodes. So every node will be a stack node, just like the linked list node in our previous class. So in this example, there are dot dots here, but let's forget about it. Let's just assume that 60 connects to 5. So what happened here is I have first inserted, pushed 5. So top was 5. Then top became 60, then top became 80, and then top became 10. Okay, so basically I only have access to the top item, which is 10, which is the youngest item, most recent item, last in item. So when I want to move something out, this will be moved out, last in, first out. Okay, so to make that possible, I will have this additional class called stack node, which will have the item like element of type object. Again, template programming, it can be integer, you can consider it like that. And then I have a pointer to a next stack node, okay, just like the linked list idea, pointer to the next node. And again, the cool part of it is, as you allocate new nodes, as you have new data, you just create a new node in your memory, okay, dynamically. Then another node comes, you create it at a random location in memory, it doesn't really matter because thanks to this next pointer, I connect that newcomer to the old one. So that's where you can really go through all your nodes. This is a linked list logic, and it is memory friendly. You don't lose any single space, except some pointer. For pointer, I am losing some memory because the real part is the data part here, like 33 here. But pointers are like 32 bit integers, so they are negligible. Let's implement the same stuff through an array. So my constructor will set the top pointer to null initially, which is for the empty stack, and is empty will check whether top pointer is null or not. If it is null, then I have an empty stack for the push. Okay, so this was my old stack from the initial slide, right? If I want to push a new number like 7, what I will do is I will do a new, so C++ thing happening here. I will create a new node, so I allocate a memory, then I set the item of that memory to this new item value, which is the input to my function. Let's call it 7. So I put 7 here. So far, so good. Then new pointer dot next. So it also has a next pointer. It will be the top pointer, which is currently 10, the top of the old stack. So remember, my current stack is like this. If you want a perfect visualization, 5 is in the bottom, 60 on top of it, preceded by 80, and 10 is in the top. So now I am at this line. New pointer dot next is the top pointer, which is this. So I am basically setting this red line. Okay, but it is not enough because so far I have access to this 10 only, 7 is missing, and I fix that with this last line. Top pointer becomes new pointer, so top becomes this. Okay, not this anymore. So see, top pointer 7, 10, 80, 65. So, and visually, this is your 7 in the top. So as simple as that. For the pop action, again, if it's empty, I just can't pop anything. I throw an exception. Otherwise, I will move top pointer to the next item. So if I want to pop it, 7 will be removed from this stack. It is the only option. You can't just remove 60 or any other node. Only the top can be moved. So remember, top pointer is 7, but I will make top equal to top dot next. So top is this, this dot next is this. So basically top becomes 10 again. So this pointer is removed. And but before all this action, I put an excess pointer here called temp, and then I delete temp. So to free up memory of this item and this pointer. So this is for memory efficiency, actually, the first and third lines. They are useful, and they shouldn't be avoided, because your item of type T can be a big item, like a megabyte of item, a gigabyte of item. I don't know, so it is not only integers, what I mean is. That's why I keep a pointer to that top, and then I remove that top, but the old top is now deleted from the memory, so that memory is released back to the operating system. So if I continue with this example, so let's make a clean pop here. So this is the current case, right? Top is pointing to 10, so this is my stack. If I pop it again, what will happen? So top is this. First, I remember this guy using something called temp for later deletion, memory deletion. But then top is equal to top dot next. So top becomes this now. So this pointer is updated. And then I delete temp, which causes the memory of 10 to be released back, and as well as this little pointer. So visually, this just happened, 80, 65. Top and pop is the same, so these three lines are exactly the same lines from the pop action. But just before doing the killing, you remember the top value at this variable called stack top. So this is the reference to your variable in your color area. So you save the item of top in that thing, and then you do the pop. For the get top, at this time you will omit this part, I guess. You will only do this thing, yes, because you are interested with the read on the operation. So you can also make this a constant function, right? Because no data member of this stack class will be updated. That's why it's constant, but this is not constant because some data members like top is getting updated here. Destructor is the function that is automatically called when the scope of that object ends, as we know from basic C++. So its task is to free up memory. So what I will do is I will use my existing functions like isEmpty. So as long as the stack is not empty, I pop the current top. I pop it, so it will attack the top item automatically. It will also automatically delete the memory for you. So if you look at the pop, we have this deleting going on as well. Another function, operator overloading happening here. I want to support assignment operation. So I have one stack S1 and I have another stack S2. I want to support this statement S1 is equal to S2. So in this case, all the content of S2 will be written to S1. So let's go visual. If your S2 is this guy, like 4, it has 3 items, 4, 3, 5. And my S1 is, it only has one item in the beginning, 6, okay, it doesn't really matter. Because what I will do is I will completely forget about the current content of S1, and in the end I will set S1 equal to 5, 3, 4. So that will be the output of this function. This, so in this case, right hand side will be S2, so this will be my right hand side, which is coming to this function, and this is this S1, this stack. So it was 6 before, and in the end of this function it will be 5, 3, 4. So first thing that comes to mind is, okay, make this empty, delete this stack. It can be done easily. But then if you pop something from right hand side and push it back to your this stack, then I will end up with this configuration, right? 5, pop 5 and push, then pop 3, push, pop 4, push. So I will end up with 4, 3, 5, which is an opposite order. It is not the right hand side, so I don't want this. I need to do something different. Okay, so this is not a very easy operation. That's why I have this many lines going on here. So first things first, if this is equal to right hand side, so if your developer is stupid enough to write a statement like this, S1 is equal to S1, so this is a redundant statement. But so if this S1 is equal to right hand side S1, then do nothing. You just return that S1. Okay. Then they are not equal, like S1 is equal to S2. But the thing is, S2.top pointer is null, meaning that S2 is empty. So I am trying to set S1 to something empty. Okay. So I can just do it, right? Top pointer will be null, so it will make, so remember, this is this s1.top pointer, it will be null. I am done. I don't really do this complicated part, and so it is also handled. Now I will do the real action. Okay, so else, so s1 is, let's remember from the beginning, it was having 6 only, and s2 is this 5, 3, 4. So I begin like this. Top pointer, I will create a total new stack, okay? So it will forget about this 6 automatically. So this new stack, top pointer, I have memory for it, but I don't have a content for it. So top.item is equal to right-hand side.top item. So, okay, right-hand side.top is currently this, right? 5. So top here, I am here, but there is no content. So make that content equal to 5. So now this just happened. Okay. Now Q will be responsible for S2 traversal and P for S1 traversal. So queue is right hand side dot next. So now this is your queue, because right hand side dot top is this. Be careful, I don't remove anything. I just advance the pointer. So it is the good thing about playing with pointers. So Q is here. Now P is this top pointer. I call it P. Now in the next iteration, if I have a Q, which I have, it is 3. So I just set the pointers. P.next, which is this node, P.next, is I create this memory. And then I set the item, the field of it, attribute of it, to q.item, which is 3. So this just happened. And then I advance the pointers. Q becomes q.next, so this is my new q. And p becomes p.next, which is this p. So okay, these old ones are done. And I will do it one more time because I have a new q, which is not null. P.next, I have memory. And p.next.item will be 4. Nice. And then advanced pointer, so this will be my new P. And this will be careful, my new Q, which is null, because next of this would be null. And when Q is null, I get out of here. And similarly, to make this stack stop, I will set this dot next to null as well. So this is how we implement your assignment operator. And this operator is used in your copy constructor. This is the point of it actually. So whatever the parameter right hand side, I will set this to that, and to make that setting, this function will be called. Yeah, so now let's test this stack class. I have an integer stack, so this is template programming again. I will push items, integers from 0 to 9. So what you observe is 0 will be in the bottom, 1, 2, and 9 will be in the top, at the top. Then I set it to S2, and then I do some trivial actions. So okay, that was the pointer-based implementation. Now I will use the same logic, but I will use a linked list. Okay, I will use the existing linked list functions like remove and insert from linked list, because something you may notice is basically given your, so this is a linked list, right? So let's talk about this stack now. Don't look at above because it is quite messy. So basically, if this is a linked list and if I want to insert a new item like to my stack, like 50, what you will do is you will insert this 50 after the zeroth node, after the dummy head of this linked list. In other words, you will call, so since this is a linked list with the next pointers and everything, I will just call linked list dot insert, which we have already implemented, this value. And then remember, insert of linked list requires a pointer after which this guy will be inserted. So in this case, it will always be the zeroth. Okay, so it will be linked list dot zeroth item, which is the dummy head. Okay, then what it does is it will set these pointers, like the next pointers, everything for you automatically. You don't really do much coding here, so it is more safe actually, because you are using something that is guaranteed to be accurate. So what I told is happening here actually. Push x is same as list.insert x after list.zeroth node. Similarly, for emptiness, look at the linked list emptiness situation. For pop, I will call the linked list.remove. Remember again, remove of linked list requires one variable of type t, of type integer, if you are having an integer linked list. And it will, so that element is that integer, and if so you will remove the first occurrence of it. So you may have duplicates in your stack, which is now a linked list. So again, 4, 3, 5, remember this is basically a linked list beginning with this as the first node. So you will get the first dot element, which is 5. And even if I have another 5 here, so let's make this stack like 5, 5, 4, it will remove this 5. Okay, because it is how we implemented linked list, the first occurrence will get removed. Okay, so these are the implementations. Array-based has this big issue of fixed size, cannot grow or shrink dynamically. Pointer-based implementations can do that. Here, the customized linked list operations, which was the second approach, and the previously defined linked list usage, same idea, it is reusing existing implementation, reduces coding effort, but maybe a little bit less efficient because you are doing more function calls because of linked lists, and every function call has this tiny overhead, but it is negligible. So these two are very quite similar. So this thing is about the array-based implementation, fixed size. When you come to the end of your array, you need to reallocate memory. So this is talking about something bad actually. But for push and pop, in the linked list, in the pointer-based stuff, you will do some three or four lines of action, like setting the next, deleting the memory, okay, operating system deletes the memory, etc. In array-based implementation, you just don't do any of them. You just increase this top variable index, remember, minus minus for pop, plus plus for push. So it is very fast actually. So there are trade-offs. And for the remaining slides, I will solve problems using stacks. So it will hopefully make stacks more clear for you. In this case, what is this? You are implementing a text editor, for instance, here. And I want to do some undos represented by this arrow. So whenever I see backspace, I will delete the last character. So A, B, C, D. So this kills D. This kills C. So be careful. Last in first out. The most recent one is out. So I don't touch A and B so far. Then F is inserted. And so my string is ABF, ABG. And because of this, the most recent one is G, not F, not B, not A. So G is getting out of my life. And ABFDL is the output. So to make that possible, we create a stack. We read new character unless it is the end of the line. I push it to the stack. So let's see visually what is happening here. Also, if it's not the backspace character, which is the special one, so in this case, A, B, C, and D is pushed to the stack. If now the character is a backspace, so I am here, and the stack is not empty, so be careful. This is also important. You shouldn't throw an exception. You pop. And you just pop it out of your stack. You don't keep the value, it is not important. Pop. So this just happened. Then second backspace pops C out of the stack. Then F comes, which lands here. And then G comes, which lands here. And then backspace comes, which kills G. So in the end, I have FBA. But I want this output to be ABF. So some reverse happening action is happening. The first fix that comes to my mind is to use a second auxiliary stack where, so this is your S1 original stack. You pop and push it here like F B A. And now you are ready to go. Now you can pop from S2 and print it to the screen like A B F. You can do another thing with that. Another application, which is not quite an application actually, display the input line reverse order. It is quite stupid. You basically have this line writing Ali, for instance. You will. What is happening really here? Since A came first, your stack looks like ALI. Here and you just pop stuff, then ILA will read. So this is not a cool application. This is the first nice application that I can verify, which is used in compilers all the time. It is about syntax. So your Parentheses should be compatible, should match. They should be balanced. But it is not as easy as saying that I have three openers and three closers, then they are balanced. It is not the case. Okay, so because you may have this configuration, sorry, opener, closer, another closer, then opener. So this is not balanced because although the number of openers and closers are the same, which is two, it is still not balanced. So this is a complicated problem, not as easy as counting the number of opening and closing parentheses. And it can be very messy. I will, but however, keep it simple using only one stack. So the idea is this. As you read your string from left to right, you skip the characters, the non-parenthesis characters, but for the parentheses you push, if it is an opener, push. So this is pushed, this is pushed. Then if it's a closer, then pop the most recent one. So because this corresponds to the most recent opener, which is this. So I am here, then I have another closer, which pops this out. And in the end, if your stack is empty, then you are good. You are balanced. Let's do unbalanced cases. Push, push, so I am here. Then I have a closer which pops this out. In the end, I don't have an empty stack, so I am definitely not balanced. So definitely. Sometimes I have empty stack in the end, like the first case here, which was balanced, but here it is not balanced. Let's see how it happens. Opener, push, closer, pop. Now stack is empty, but string isn't over yet. And as soon as you see the next closer, you will see that I have an empty stack, so you will quit the loop and say that it is not balanced. So the way we implement this is also simple. So balance so far, this is for early break. I is going to run from 0 to n minus 1, where n is the length of the string. Character, get the character at position I. So if your string is s, basically it's an array of characters, right? S, I. Then increase I for the next iterations. Now, it's an opener, push it. There is no question. If it's a closer, then be careful. If the stack is empty, then balance so far is false. So, because there is a problem. So it will quit this loop early. And since balance so far is false, it says it is not balanced. But if the closer is seen and the stack isn't empty, you just pop the most recent opener. And you do it like this, like this, like this. And in the end, balance so far is kept as true. And stack is also empty. Be careful, so I am not hitting this case. So I will say balanced. Another problem, again, it can be cast as a compiler problem because your compiler may be requiring your variables to be of some type, of some, have some pattern. So in this case, the language of your words to be supported will be W special W prime, where W prime is the reverse. So ABC special dollar, CBA okay, AA okay, null null okay, ABC dollar, ABC not okay because this is not the reverse of ABC, A dollar B totally not okay, A dollar null not okay. So I can solve this problem using a stack. I will push everything to my stack until I see the special character dollar. So it will look like this, A, B, C. Dollar, I don't do any push, but I will change my mode now. Now I will go to pop mode. So I will pop C, compare it with the next character. Okay. Pop B, so this is gone. B versus next, okay. And pop A, A versus A, okay. And string over, stack empty, so we are good. I recognize this is in my language. But maybe I have one more character, like it is CBAI here. four character long string, then I have one new character but stack empty, so say no, not in my language, and stuff like that. Yeah, so this is the also there are other cases, like as soon as you see, so let's do this case, ABC is in my stack, so these are very simple, I'm embarrassed to do them, but just in case. Now I am in the pop mode, so look at pop it and look at it C. So you do get top and pop, right? You call top and pop. Your top value was stored in this C variable and it has the value of C. C versus A, not okay, so quit immediately. Don't even look at the upcoming letters and tell that it is not in my language. So to implement this, until we see the dollar, we push blindly, and then we do something very similar to the parentheses balancing actually. Another cool application, algebraic expression, conversion and evaluation. So we are familiar with something called infix expression, where operator is in like between operands. But there's a problem with that. There is this precedence of operator issue. As human beings, we are familiar, so it is not a very big deal for us. We can immediately see that multiplication beats addition, so it is 2 times 3, 6 plus 5, 11. But what if your statement was something like this? Okay, so the operators are maybe not known. So this is actually how a machine sees it. It doesn't have any human experience. So should that machine do 1-2 and then do the result 1-2 and then apply that result? First do 1-2, you have some scalar value, and then apply dollar to that scalar value and 3. This is one option. Or first two dollar 3 and then dash that result with 1. So which one? It is totally ambiguous. So that is the problem with infix expression. But with postfix or prefix, its sister, it is definitely not ambiguous, as we will see. So there is only one understanding of this statement, which is the following. Postfix means operator is post after the operand. So when you see an operator, just these are binary operators. It can also be unary, but if it is unary, just look at the first item back. If it is binary, look at 2 items back. If it is ternary, look at 3 items back, etc. So these are binary operators. So multiplication applies to 3 and 2. 3 times 2, 6. So I have now 5, 6 plus. And then I have an operator, then this is second operand, this is first operand, 6, 5 plus 6 is 11, so your result is 11. And there is no other way to evaluate this. Prefix, so I will focus on postfix, because prefix is the same idea, except operator is in the beginning, pre, not post. So in this case, operator will hit this 2, 3, it will be 6, then 5, 6 plus 11, so same result. So let's stick with postfix then. So in this case, don't even look at infix. 5, 2, multiply, 10. 10, 3, plus, 13. And here what's happening is 2, 3, plus, I have a 5. Then 5, 5, multiply, 25. Then I have 25, 4, minus. And according to my rule, this is the operand 2, this is 1, always. So 1 minus 2 is 21, positive. Okay, so that is the logic. Let's see what it is talking here. Infix notation is easy to read for humans. Yes, I agree. But postfix or prefix is easier to parse for a machine. The big advantage in postfix is that there never arise any questions like operator precedence. So I don't have to know the priorities of the operators. That is the coolest part. That's why machines need postfix or prefix expression. So you need to evaluate a postfix expression, and also you need to convert infix to postfix, okay, to make it ready for your machine in a calculator application, for instance. So let's first do the evaluation. If this is your expression, so let's go through this example. My expression is 3, 4, plus, and multiple. So what is waiting me here? So I will have a stack, obviously. For the evaluation, I will populate the stack with the operands, okay, operands like numbers. For the conversion, I will populate it with the operators. So let's leave conversion to the later slide. Let's stick with the evaluation here. Remember, I will populate the stack with the numbers. So 2 comes, just push it to your stack. 3 comes, push it to your stack. No questions asked. 4 comes, push it to your stack. Now be careful. I have a none number, none operand. In other words, I have an operator. So pop twice, which makes an access to the most recent 2 items. So this will be operand 2, O2. This will be O1. And then do what your operator dictates, like plus addition. You should know that. So 3 plus 4 is 7. So be careful. These are popped and saved at O2. Popped and saved at O1. Then do the operation and it gives you 7 because of 3 plus 4. Then push it back. So let's rewrite this for clarity. I already have 2. Now push the result, which is 7. And proceed. So this is done. Next character is another operator. Pop twice. This is popped, removed from the stack, and it is saved in O2, operand 2. This is popped from stack and saved in operand 1. And then do whatever the operator dictates, which is multiplication. So 2 times 7 is 14. And again, just like before, push the result back to the stack. Then try to continue, but there is nothing. Then you are guaranteed, if your expression is valid, you are guaranteed to have 1 scalar waiting for you in your stack. And it will be the only item in your stack, so there is no ambiguity. 14 is your result. Conversion, remember what I told you, in the conversion, I will populate the stack with the operators. So basically, I will send the operands directly to the screen as my output, as my conversion output. So let's first see the action mathematically. This is my infix. I want to end up with this, right? So what is this doing? I will have, in the end, I will have some scalar value because of this division, and I will subtract it from A. So subtraction should be the very last item. Now let's see it step by step. C times D, which is this. I will add B to them. And then that thing will get divided by E. Okay. That thing is this. Will get divided by E. So these are done. And that thing will be subtracted from A. So this is the output I am looking for. Let's see how I can get it. A. So I am, this is my input. Reading from left to right. A character, just print it to the output, or just keep this output to in a string, whatever. So let's say print. I am just printing it directly. A. Then be careful. Minus comes. Just push it to the stack. Parenthesis. It is an operator. It is something to do with your operation, so it is not an operand, so push it. Then B, just print it. So I am do the print here. A was printed, now B, print. Then plus comes, again, push to the stack, it's an operator. Then C comes, print, no questions asked. Then multiply comes, again, push to the stack. Then, now the first interaction has interesting action. I have a closer. So I don't push a closer to a stack. What I instead do is I will pop stuff until the corresponding opener. So pop this and print. Okay. So it will automatically hit the most recent 2 when I am evaluating it. Pop this and print. And pop this. It is an opener. So don't print. It is an opener, special case. Don't print and also finish the popping, finish that sequence of action. It is a stopper. Then continue. This is my stack. It only has minus in it. I have a new operator division. Push it. Then I have a character printed. Then what happened? So I will do the pops whenever I see a closer or whenever I am done. I see a null, the terminator character. So I will just pop and print. Pop this. So not in the stack anymore, print. And pop this. Not in the stack anymore and print. And if you double click, I get the result. Yeah. And so the way to implement this is just like I described. If you have an opener, push it. If you have an operand, just print it. Or in this case, they are not printing it, but they're appending it to the output variable called postfix expression. If you have a closer, you just until you see the opener, the first opener, which is automatically corresponding to the closer, do the pops and pops. Be careful and first get the top, append, and then pop. So we proceed like this, and in the end there may be remaining additional operators in your stack. Just push pop them out of your stack and print to the screen or append to your result. Now another important application of stack is its relationship with recursion. There will be a strong relationship. Indeed, every recursive function can be made non-recursive using stacks. But these all come from the fact that stacks are useful for functions, so not just recursion. Basically, stacks are used again by compilers. In the background, you will always see a stack in your program, so it's very important. During execution, each function call generates an activation record, like where did I come from, what are my local variables here, etc. So some meta information, this activation record. And actually there is a term called Stack Overflow. It also has a website apparently. So where does it occur? These little activation records, they get accumulated, and if you make too many function calls, which happens especially in recursive calls, because in recursion you don't really control, it is easy to make a mistake. For instance, you can forget to put your base case, or your base stopping condition can never happen. So then this number of function calls will make stack overflow. So it's, you don't fall into this trap with regular non-recursive programs, because you are controlling your function calls there. But with recursive functions, you are likely to end up with a stack overflow due to the accumulation of these records if you are not careful enough. First, see how the runtime stack works. So with every program, even if it's not recursive, I have some stack going on in the background. So the use is like this. I start with the main. So it is the node with the local variables here, like i5. Then when I make a function call, I create a new activation record. Okay, so here this node has its own local variables like kj, or yes, k and j. J is, be careful, it is again related to this function, it's the argument to this function, and k is the local variable, but in the end they all belong to this node. Then it calls bar, so I create another node in my runtime stack, and when bar is over, I pop it out and I come back to the most recent item, which is foo. Be careful. So I come back to this line. So I don't just jump back to main, because there is an order here, and I can establish that order using a stack. Now let's see stack with a recursive function, where I compute n factorial using this basic recursive definition. N factorial is equal to n times n minus 1 factorial. So this is just math, and I argue that this is the simplest recursive function you can write. So if n is 0, 0 factorial is 1, by default I return a scalar value. Otherwise I return the current n times recursive call to the n minus 1 factorial. So let's see how the stack gets populated here. If I want to compute 3 factorial, which is 6, I don't just get the number 6 magically. This is how the recursive magic happens. 3 is not 0, so I don't quit. I just make a new call to fact2. So which goes to the runtime stack on top of 3. So this is about fact2. But fact2 calls fact1. Fact1 still not, this is fact1. It is not enough to stop. It is not the base case. So fact1 calls fact0. Now I am at fact0. Be careful. Since fact0 is defined as 1, it returns a scalar value 1. So that value now, so this function is over. It's completely done. But be careful, these recursive functions are not done yet. So 1, which is the result of fact0, comes here, right? This node. So let's continue. Okay, that one came here. So this finishes fact1. So fact1 node is also done from my runtime stack. With that information, fact1 is finalized. I know that the answer is 1 because of 1 times 1. So it also finishes fact2 with 2 times 1. And it eventually finishes fact3 because it was waiting for fact2 to finish, and it has finished with the value of 2. So it puts the scalar 2 here. 3 times 2 is 6. It is returned, and see how the stack has helped me to do that. How do I print a string in reverse order? So this is not, again, in the background of this recursion, there are stacks. So that's why I first show you the recursive solution. Then I will also show you the explicit stack solution. But the recursive solution is kind of cool. I like this. So if your stack string is ABC, you need to print CBA. So see what happens. ABC comes here. Look at the first character. So this is just looking at the first character, like str0, notation convenience in C++ or C also, it holds. So it calls, remember, ABC comes here. I will call it with the next character, with the string starting with the next character, str+1, again, some string arithmetic happening. So this ABC calls print reverse. So let me also write it explicitly, PR. But it calls PR with starting with the first character and the all other characters, so BC. And so now I am with BC here, which is not null. It will call C because the next character, the string BC, if I take the substring starting with the first character, it will be C. So now C is here, not null. It will print, call print reverse with the null, because C and the next of C will be null, the terminating character, which is this null. So when I come here with that null character, it won't get in because of the if condition, so it just dies out. When it dies out, I come back to the most recent call in my runtime stack, which is this. So it has done the calling part. Now it will print the first character of what it has, which is C. So it will print C. And I am done with this. Come back to the next item, just like the factorial example, BC. I am done with the recursive part. First character of the BC, which is, so this is the first character, remember, which is B. Then done with this. Then first character of ABC, which is A. CBA is printed. I can also do it without recursion at all. So I will, until I see the last character, I push everything to my stack. So remember, ABC was the input. So first A, then B, then C, then this null terminator isn't pushed because of this condition. Then I just top and pop. So pop also store the result using reference to C. Remember, there was this symbol in the top and pop, so it makes call by reference to C. So actually it also gets the value C, kind of a bad coincidence, but anyway, C, and print C. Then pop top is B, set it to C, and pop it. So then printed. So I have already printed C, then B is printed, and in the end A is removed, printed, and now stack is empty, so it is true. Not true is a false. I quit. Another example, maze solving. Like you are in a maze, how to solve it? So we are doing something about games here, which should excite you maybe. So the idea is the following. First, you need to represent your maze with a 2D array. Okay, for obstacles I will use number 1. For empty slots I will use number 0. Okay, so this can be done in the pre-processing. Then at any given node I am allowed to go, so I will use the same ordering. So I will first try up, then right, then down, then left. So the order here isn't important, but the important thing is you will stick with this ordering at any point during the execution. So URDL. So try up, this is not okay. But when I start here, so push this node to your stack. So basically you will push the index of this node. What is it? If I have zero base indexing, this is row 1, column 0. So I have 1, 0 in my stack, for instance. The trace points are pushed to the stacks in case I come back here. Actually, we have already seen something in our backtracking slides, for which there is another video in my channel. So you can also look at that. I don't remember if I solved the maze solving there, but I did n queens problem and another. So I haven't done it, but this is an application of a backtracking. And for that, I need to push every current point to the stack in case I come back to that point later for a different decision. So this is in my stack. Up is not possible, but right is possible. So go here and push this also to my stack in case I come back. So what is it? It is 1, 1. Then try up, no, try right here. Similarly, right. And at this node, be careful, and I have already pushed all these nodes here. At this node, up is not okay, right is not okay, down is not okay, and left is also, you set a boolean visited for every entry. Left is visited, so I am stuck. What you do is you pop it out and you try the next decision of this node. So I have already did up and right here, so continue with the ordering. Try down. Try left. Both are sucking, so both are dead ends. Do nothing. Pop it out. So you pop like this. You come back to this point, and from this point now I will be trying down, which will allow me go here. Then for this node I can go down. For this node I will not go further because remember the ordering: first up, no, then right, which is okay. So I will go here, here, then here, here, and here, here, here. So you can exit. Actually, when I am here, I first try up. Remember the ordering. So I will go here and then come back, and from here I will quit. So, but the idea is clear, hopefully. So move forward if possible. If not, pop until a new direction move is possible. Another application that is in most calculators. So I want to convert integer to binary. So binary to integer is easy. So just remember, if this is your binary number, basically we multiply it from right to left with the powers of 2s, right? So 1, 2, 4, and in this case, I accumulate 1 and 4, which is 5. So this is the binary representation of 5. But how do I go from 5 to this? Or let's stick with this example, 232 to binary. But it is about 233 actually, so my bad. It doesn't really matter. But the idea is the following. Let's stick with the 233. You divide it by 2. Okay. You will end up with 1, 1, 6, and the remainder is your binary digit. You will push it to your stack. Okay, one. Then do the same. Divide by 2. Some result, in this case I think 58, right? And the remainder would be 0. Push it to the stack. Then let's do one more thing. 2, 29 is the result, and remainder is again 0. So push it here. So hopefully I'm continuing with that logic here. So I have done up to this part. Then if I continue, 29 gets divided by 2 with one remainder. This is that. Then 14 is the result. For 14 there is no remainder. For 7 there is a remainder. For 3 there is a remainder. And then I have 1. 1 over 2. There is a remainder, which is 1. And when you set your stack like this, to get your result, you will just read this from in reverse order. So basically, your output will be, so I will finish somewhere here, it will be read in this order. So this is the stack logic, last in, first out. In other words, first in will be last out. So in this case, it happens to be 1, so I'm reading from above, 1, 1, 0, 1, 0, 0, 1. So let's just double check. This is supposed to be 1, 2, 4, 8, not 16, 32, 64, and the next power of 2 is 1 to 8, 128. If you make a quick sum here, I already have 9, 41, 64, 105, plus this, yes, 233. Nice. And the way we implement this is, as long as I have, so I divide the number by 2 at every iteration, and as long as it is bigger than 0, like 1 is also going to be processed in the end, I push the remainder to the stack. I get the remainder, of course, first, so you can just forget about deadline and put that here. But again, it's not about efficiency. Then you will read the stack from top to the bottom, which comes naturally. And how about the time complexity of this algorithm? Given a number n, is it on? And based on the spacing here, I think you understand that it is not. It is log n, right? Because your problem size is n, actually. The value of, not only one. The problem size is the value of n. And that size gets halved at every iteration. So this is the part. So n becomes then n over 2, then n over 3, n over 4, then n over 16, etc. Right? I decrease half by half. And this is where the logarithmic complexity comes in, like as we have studied in the binary search. And I will finish with two interview questions from Amazon and Facebook, big companies like that. The first interview question that I want to deal with is about finding the minimum in a stack in constant time. Okay, so this is probably the tricky part here, constant time, because given a stack, so first things first, if you are in an interview, you should first give the naive solution or even a bad solution that is not even an answer here, but it is related. So I can solve this problem in on time, right? If this is my stack with some stuff in it, like 4, 2, 6, 5, and 7. So I can pop stuff, and I also keep a variable called min, global minimum. If pop it, but then I also need to recover the stack, right? So maybe, so let's first do it like this. Pop the value 7, which is the current minimum, then pop it 5, current minimum, 6 no effect, 2 is the minimum, and 4 doesn't change the minimum. So the answer is 2, but I have answered the minimum query in on time, but the thing is I have ruined my stack. Now my stack is empty, so it is totally not a valid solution, but it is just a starting point, like warm up during your interview or whatever. let's do this function like this. I won't update the time complexity of the traditional operations as well. Be careful, push, pop, and top. So how about maintaining a global minimum variable as I do the pushes, so from scratch. So assume that my sequence is 4, 2, 6, 5, 7, okay? And there is this global minimum in my class. So when I do the push, first 4 comes, I look at the minimum, which is infinity. So minimum is, I push it here, 4. And minimum is 4. So push is okay. 2, I push it as usual. Also update the minimum because it defeats 4. Then 6, push as before, as traditional way. Try to update 2, no, because 2 is better. 5, just do the regular pushing. Don't update minimum, which is 2 here. And then 7, push. With your stack array implementation or linked display implementation, whatever, it is all one time complexity. And don't update minimum. So minimum is 2. Let me rewrite it here. So all the pushes all one time. Wonderful. Top 7, I can still get it in all one time. Pop is also all one time. So if I want to pop something, I pop 7. Okay, I end up with 5. And minimum is still 2. So what is the problem here? Let's think about it. There is a problem. It's not a good solution. Actually, the problem is in the pop operation. What if I pop 2? What if I pop as many elements as possible until 2? And then I pop 2 also. It can happen. So I can't have any control over these things. So when I pop 2 out of my life, what is the next minimum? So when I get rid of 2, in this case it takes 1, 2, 3, 4 pops. So okay, when I pop this 2, what will I put here? In this case, obviously put the next value, which is 4, but you get the logic, right? This stack might be very longer, like 2 is like in the middle. I have other values here, 6, 10, maybe a 1 here, then I have a 71 here, etc. So in other words, after every pop you need to look at the new traverse through the new traverse through the remaining stack, the new stack, yeah, because you popped it. You need to update your minimum value. In this case you will set it to 1, but it will make pop incredibly inefficient. It will be O(n) cost, because in the worst case, every pop has this danger of updating the real global min, removing the global min. So you need to look at all O(n) remaining items to update it properly. So it is a bad solution. It is not a good solution. It is not the correct solution. So let's go to a good solution. I have two solutions. First, I can use a second auxiliary stack that keeps the minimum along with my original stack. So in this example, so let's get rid of this part. Actually, let me draw it again. So insertion order is 4, 2, etc. So I insert, this is my stack 1, S1. I insert 4 here. Meanwhile, I push the current minimum to the second step called S2. So in this case, 4 will be pushed here. Now 2 comes. 2 versus the top element here, which is the minimum, right, of this layer. 2 is better, so I will push 2 here. Then 6 comes. Push 6 here regularly, again all one time. This is just a regular push. Additionally, in the push, I look at the top of S2, which is another constant operation. There is no for loop. I just look S2.top. So it is 2. 2 versus 6. 6 is not good, so within that push, I will also do another pop, another push to S2. So it will twice the runtime of my regular push, but theoretically it's still O1. So I am good to go. Again, I will push 2 here because 2 was the winner. Now 5 comes, push the regular way. 5 versus the top 2. So push the copy of 2 here, which is 2. And 7. Then So basically, visually, what's happening here is the winner of every layer is on the right hand side. So up to this point it is 2, up to this point it is 2, 2, but the winner of everything below here is 4. So maybe I might have other values like 100, 200 here. 4 is there. Yeah, so that is the idea, which makes every operation in O1 time. And now to answer O1 minimum query, you will just look at S2.top, which is still O1. Another solution, I will use a minimum variable, but it won't be a global one. It will be a local one. It will be attached to each node. So be careful. Before, I was using next and element or value. Now I will also use min. So I will proceed like this. 4 is inserted. I will use this notation dot. What is the current minimum? 4. So with that node, the minimum will keep 4. Okay. So this is that node's value. This is that node's minimum field. Then comes 2. So push it. But 2 dot min will be 2, because I will look at like in this diagonal way. 2 versus the minimum of the current stack is here. 4, so 2 beats it. Then comes 6. 6, look at the current minimum, which can be obtained by looking at the minimum of the most recent item, because it keeps the current minimum. So 2, still 2 is good, better than 6, so 6.2. Then 5 versus 2. 2 is the winner. I use 2 with me. Then 7 versus 2. These 2 still 2. Let's do one more insertion, like 10. Actually, it is not necessary. 10 to, I will just put 10 to there. So now this is the push. When you make a pop, you just do a regular pop. You get rid of this. Then when you make a minimum query, you just look at the top and read the minimum field of that thing. Okay, top.min. Okay, so this is the idea. Again, all operations would be in O1 time. And sort a stack, where I will be using an additional structure again. It will be from the same stack family, but it is not a rule. You can use another structure as well, but in this problem, using an additional stack will be sufficient. So this is my input 1, 3, 2, 4. In the end, I want to sort it. Okay, it will be 1, 2, 3, 4. So how do I proceed? This is the top, right? So 1, take 1. So this is the first stack, input stack. This is the second stack. So there is also this temp variable. Let me rewrite it here. In whatever you pop from the first stack, you keep it here, so it is 1. So test it with the top of this second stack, S2. There is nothing to test, so just blindly push it here, 1. So this is gone now from the first stack. So I want to use this. I will use this. This is already my first stack, right? So let's make it look like a stack, maybe. Now, 3. 3 is my new temp, okay? But the 3, if 3 is less than the top here, I am good. I just blindly inserted. But it is not the case. 3 is bigger than this, so I am not happy with this value. So what I do is I pop it here and push it back. So also remember, 3 was popped here and saved in temp. So this is 2, 4 only. But 1, I don't like it here, so I pop it out. But where do I put it back? C is reserved. So I will put it back here. So this is the current step. 1, 2, 4. Now 3 versus the top of S2, which is nothing. So just blindly put 3 here. Okay. Now in the next iteration, see what is going to happen. 1 versus, so 1 is the new temp. 1 is smaller than 3. So there is nothing wrong with the ordering. I just push it. So 1 is popped. Now pop 2, it is gone, but save it here. Temp is 2 now. Okay. 2 is not smaller than the top one. So do the same. What is the same? Pop it out and where do I push it back to my original stack? So it is now 1-4. And now try to put 2 here. 2 versus 3. Okay, it doesn't change the order, ruin the order. So I will put 2 here. Okay, this is the stack 2 and 3. Now continue. This stack has 1-4 in it. This stack has 2-3 in it. 1 is my temp. I pop 1, so remove it. I save it in my temp variable. Now 1 versus 2, I am very good because it doesn't hurt the ordering, 1, 2. And by definition, everything below is already sorted. So it is done. Now 4 comes, be careful. Pop it out. Save it in my temp. And now try to put it here, but no, there is a problem. 4, 1. So do the same. What was the same? Pop it out. Push it here. So let me rewrite. See, 1 is here. Now 4 versus 2. Not good. Get rid of 2 and save it here. 4 versus 3. 4 is not smaller. So pop it out. Put it here. Now 4 versus nothing. 4 is obviously the winner. Let me make a clean copy. So push it. And then repeat everything from scratch. So this is the top. 3 is my new temp. 3 and 4. There shouldn't be any problem, right? It is clear. And for the rest, there won't be any problem. So 2 versus 3. Again, I won't update temp anymore. 2 is here. And then 1 versus 2. 1 is here. And it is sorted. What is the time complexity of this thing? So there has been some flushing everyone. If you notice, when I did 4, I flushed everything out and put it here. So in the worst case, I put every n items from one stack to other, and it can happen in every step with every number. So O n times n, which is O n square, would be the time complexity here. And that settles it actually. I hope the stack issue is clear. Yes, thanks.